So when Parminder told me that he wanted me to talk a little bit about what has IT or digital done to the world around us, I could only think of one word, and that was disruption. Yeah, and disruption at a massive scale, and disruption that is happening on an everyday basis to everyone around the globe. And it is not a far-fetched reality that in a couple of years' time, there won't be a single person in the world who's not affected by digital on a daily basis. I think a lot of us here in this room, and especially in the social sector, don't realize that. We let it hit us, and then we try to make the best use of it. If you compare it with other sectors, that people have actually made huge loads of money out of digital, and it's amazing that we have talents that we ship from India to other countries who make Zynga games, and in India we have made Ola, we made contributed to Uber apps. We have apps like Zomato. So if you want to eat Chinese food, you download the app. And you say, you know, I want to eat Chinese. It exactly tells you where to find Chinese food, which are the best restaurants. There is a community around it. But it's sad that, just to talk to it about what Kalyani was mentioning, that if a woman is being abused at home, or she is a victim of domestic violence, or that she doesn't really have, she can't do these things. Yeah? On one side, people can find where the best Chinese food is available. On the other side, access to tools is not pretty much in the same level. So I think disruption has played digital rights as a disruptive force has had positive as well as negative impacts. I'm not going to focus on either, but just going to give you some examples of how it has changed the way that we look at the world around us. So what has happened I'm going to quote from examples in that we did in Amnesty, because it is quite relevant to the discussion that we are having here, especially for the rights-based conversation that we've had in the previous session, is when 2012, when we started Amnesty in India, and I was part of the founding team, the definition of digital globally was, you know, anyone with an email ID or a Facebook account or a Twitter account. But we wanted to see, but are these the people for whom the rights-based issues are a daily issue? Are those the ones that are affected by those issues? And the answer was no. And we realized that, are there other means of what if we expanded the meaning of digital? What if we included mobiles? Because at that time, the number of mobiles. Something very different. So we thought that if we wanted to solve problems at scale, we had to take digital on board. And we decided that instead of investing in Facebook and Twitter kind of campaigning, because there were other organizations who were doing it well, we thought Amnesty could do something different, and we decided to go the mobile way. And we took up this course about justice in Sri Lanka, which was very popular and important cause for the Tamil, especially the Tamilian audience at that point of time. And we decided, what if we created a community around mobile phones for this cause? And that is when we thought about innovation in the digital field. We realized that innovation is not what is new for us. It is what is new for the audience or the community. So as leaders of people, I see a lot of people who are doing their IT courses, computer science graduates. When we think of innovation, we need to start thinking about people who we are innovating for, what is new for them. SMS might not be new for us, but for them, activism through SMS was a completely new concept. So we set up a missed call number. We had some channels through which we could flash these numbers and say, hey, if you believe in this cause, if you want to take injustice personally, give a missed call to this number. Be a part of this community that we are trying to build. And within, we had a target of reaching out to 10,000 people in 2 months, and we reached 3 million people. Yeah? And the reason we were able to do that is because by the time we realized that digital has actually disrupted the entire conversations that were happening in this sector. And we realized that it was disrupting it on a daily basis, which is when we moved to the second year of our operations in Amnesty, a lot of people were moving on to WhatsApp. And I'm talking about 95% of this audience is all rural audience. So most of our activists that joined most our campaigns, our major campaign, where 95% of them were the rural Tamil Nadu, for example. So it was a great learning for us, and that's when we started realizing that we need to, the way digital is changing the rights framework work that even global brands like Amnesty were doing, was completely, it was a fundamental change to what was happening before that. Yeah, and that's, we started noticing a lot of problems. If you can see that e-governance portals that governments constantly talk about is actually owned by the government. So you might all remember what happened with the TRAI leaking of email addresses. They ran a campaign and people signed. It is great that people signed the campaign, and they just released all the data. Right? That shows us that, you know, organizations like Facebook, Google, or even governments for that matter, I don't see them any different from governments. Eh? The fact that on a daily basis we use digital tools and technologies, but very, very few of us even understand how these technologies work is a big risk. The moment I go to organizations and tell them, you know, technology for social change, for example, the moment they hear the word technology, the change part of it disappears from their head. They step back. They think that you are going to change the way completely, that they're going to implement a particular solution. So it is important as leaders that we try to work together as a group and evolve leaders in the IT field who don't look at it as a software or a solution, but understand what are the problems that are happening, right, in the social sector, and create solutions which are specific to that problem. And not to try something radical, because if we go ahead and try radical solutions to problems, instead of fixing the small vulnerabilities that existing solutions might have, for example, let's say Anganwadi workers in Andhra Pradesh or Orissa are actually doing data collection, right? Now, what I mean by a radical IT solution, technology solution will be, you know, we'll buy some tablets, we'll create some amazing software, and this is going to do it. That's, for me, it's a radical IT solutions. And I have, in my past experience, seen that whenever solutions are radical, you forget thinking about what is that incremental change that you want to see in the society. So instead of doing that, you should first ask the question, what is the problem that they are facing? They are collecting the data. So are they collecting it on paper? Is there a way for them to continue collecting it on paper? And we transferring the data onto creating these middle paths that will help us gradually change the problem, instead of completely eradicating, let's say, you know, Anganwadi workers will not be able to do this, right? So train them, use them, and have that in. So I think it's important to create those kind of incremental changes and change the way that people look at technology and not look at it as a tool that is going to disrupt the solutions that they have already set up. And we also need it has also created the digital rights movement in India is also creating a need for a particular set of human resources that we all need to actively look for. It cannot be an entity that is there. You know, you can't say that, hey, my nonprofit has an IT function that takes care of innovation and technology. That's not going to happen. Unless everyone is going to constantly become, it's a very cliche word to use, IT savvy. Yeah, and it is going to happen whether we like it or not. People are going to happen because it's a daily reality that we are facing. So we need to constantly look at that. IT is going to, digital is going to help us solve problems and at scale. It is going to create problems at scale, which some of us have already mentioned about. We talked about ISIS, we talked about governments getting uprooted because of easy access to communities. We are talking about millions of records of data in India to create a very bottoms-up approach to it through community building, through understanding, okay, what is your basic right to you? One of the sessions that we are going to do is around what we think is our rights in the digital age. Problem at this stage. I am very confident that as we move further down, we will be able to make huge changes in the way this is the digital disruption is happening. And one thing that we should, as a closing note, one thing that we should remember is that if you remember 1 year ago, 2 years ago, there was no Ola, there was no Uber, most of these things were there. So we are completely unprepared. The jobs that are available today in the IT sector were not even thought of 5 years ago. Yeah? So we are in a sector that is getting disrupted every day. We are talking about problems which we cannot even imagine what they are going to be. It's very different from the other problems that traditionally as a group we might have dealt with. It is both challenging as well as scary. challenging because it's going to be exciting to solve those problems, and scary because I'm afraid that these kind of work should have started 5-6 years ago. We should have started thinking about frameworks a long time back. But it is good that we are starting now, and we should focus on that and see that in terms of problem solving at scale, we come up with great, I am expecting great solutions that nonprofits and social enterprises are going to come up in India. Like, I wouldn't be very surprised if, let's take Enriga, a person is walking out of his house and he has his $1,000 on a Chinese-made mobile phone, and he can actually find work at the click of a button. I mean, if you can find a cab at a click of a button, if people can find Chinese food at a click of a button, we should soon be able to find use technology in ways where solutions can be introduced at scale and implemented through and impact measured. So that is where I think the good disruption is going to come from, and we all as members have seen have all a key role to play in making sure that IT in our respective lives or in our organization doesn't get marginalized into someone who is fixing email addresses, right? Which happens a lot. So we need to, and we need to empower people to think and adopt IT in a way that will make them part of the change and not something, okay, yeh ho gaya hai, now let's ask our IT guy to, we have designed this problem, why don't you write an app to solve this problem? That is not the way that problems will be solved. It has to be, you have to get that person inside, you have to get your IT function as part of the problem solving. Hey, we are talking about rights here, what do you think about it? What are your thoughts about it? Let's solve this problem together. Right now, that's not how it is happening. So you'll see nonprofits, especially working, they come up with a framework, and then they, I mean, we are in Bangalore, right? You go to the street and say website, there'll be 10 people coming to you. It's a software hub. But that is exactly the reason why websites fail. There are exactly reasons why apps fail, because the solution maker is always called in the end. So it's a desperate call to everyone to ensure that don't be afraid to call your IT people. Even if you're working with agencies, or vendors, make them part of the problem-solving process. That's going to help you. Don't be scared of them. They're not going to, write code. They're not going to do anything disruptive in that fashion. So I'll try to. Thank you.